Next is the recent advances of fungal diagnostics and application in Asian countries. Okay, first thing is that, look at the disease which we are handling in case of invasive fungal infection. This particular disease, if not treated, mortality is 100%. Even if you treat, the mortality is no less, around 50%. Why so poor outcome despite antifungal? The basic thing is that in case of management of fungal infection, we say the management dictum is that do early diagnosis and give prompt therapy. Now the clinician's dilemma is that, okay, you say to me that you diagnose and then only give therapy for antifungal stewardship program, but which patient is having fungal infection when the clinical symptoms are non-specific and even imaging is not helping mostly? We are seeing a lot of immunocompetent patients where there is fungal infection, but there is nothing which can really suggest. In immunosuppressed patients, we see halo sign, Erkrasen sign, but then again, this is not specific. There are several other situations which can be there. This is the paper which this year again, February 2017, we published together. We said that delivering on antimicrobial resistance agenda not possible without improving fungal diagnostic capability. Even antibiotics, there is the problem because which patient is having fungal sepsis, we don't know. And mostly we are giving antibacterial drug in any patient in case of sepsis. Already you heard about the discussion on chronic pulmonary aspergillosis. If you fail to diagnose, quite a number of these patients go with the second line antitubercular therapy. In case of fungal asthma and invasive aspergillosis of COPD, misdiagnosis is very common. And because of that, we are giving unnecessary antibacterial drugs. Even in case of pneumocystis pneumonia, which is either overtreatment or undertreatment is there. So access to the advanced fungal diagnosis, which would benefit clinical outcome, if it is not available, there is problem in case of even antibacterial stewardship program. I'm giving one example. If anybody who is intensivist, and I ask him that you diagnose and then treat, what is the scenario at present in candida sepsis in ICU? Blood culture positivity is only 50%. We say that we have got some clinical scores out there, like candida score, like colonizing index. If blood culture fails, at least it can help. But you know, colonizing index, you have to do at least sampling 5 samples colonization site daily from the patient. Think about in ICU, which have 20-bedded hospital. Every day you are sending at least 100 samples to the microbiology laboratory for look into the colonization. Is it possible? Is it cost effective? And in case of at least Asian scenario, we think it is impractical. Moreover, when we did a study, this is a study which is done in case of Lucknow, in case India, that Barunia found that 97% patients are colonized with candida anytime in case of ICU. So how we can really solve this problem? Ostrowski's rule, which is when the patient is on ventilator, this is easier to implement, but only 10% of the patients develop probable aspergillosis. So do you know which patient to be treated with antifungal when predictive rule, candida score, blood culture fail? And we always raise this question, if diagnosis, in diagnosis, more failure than success. Look into this AIDS physician. They are crying horse because how to diagnose IRS. Of course, if you have got real clinical acumen, you can suspect it, but it's very difficult. Hematologists, they are still not very clear when these symptoms are signs and non-specific. Same problem with the transplant physician. In case of intensivists, they were handling somehow the candida sepsis, they learned somehow this candida sepsis can be handled this way. But now we are saying that mycelial fungal infection in ICU is also not so uncommon. So they don't know how to diagnose it. Pulmonologists, they were diagnosing histoplasma and others, but now the problem came with the chronic pulmonary aspergillosis and other lung infection. And surgeons, they never used to handle fungal infection. They used to know only bacterial infection. But now, what it had been found that in case of acute pancreatitis, there are cases of candida pancreatitis. And in case of this, especially when there are multiple leaks, you can have intra-abdominal candidiasis. How to diagnose all this? If you ask me the question, I say, if Google has no answer to all the question, how can I answer all your question in that scenario? But friends, always I am not pessimist. I find always optimist. Is there any progress? Is there any light at the end of the tunnel? I say that you can improve the diagnosis. Look into the sample collection. I know it's very difficult to get samples, especially if the patient is thrombocytopenic, and it is difficult to avoid colonizer to collect from the upper or lower respiratory tract infection. But what I found and learned from some of the people in the Western world, that if in a thrombocytopenic patient, if you can give two fresh plasma, you can go ahead for doing fine needle aspiration cytology. For last 5 to 6 years in our center, we have improved a lot in case of diagnosis by doing this fine needle aspiration cytology, especially with CT guided. Direct microscopic culture and histopathology, we say it is insensitive, slow, difficult to distinguish from the colonizer. But suppose if you have got a good mycologist, just on direct microscopy, detected PCP or pneumocystis zero vesi, immediately you can start the therapy. So the direct microscopy is so good, it can pick up the cases much earlier. If you can see mycelial fungi, that is also very useful. Next important issue is the identification. It's important as you choose the drug depending on this identification. I know the phenotypic method is time consuming and there is problem in case of phenotypic method that you have heard of Candida auris. But you know, if we can have MALDI, I always say that you cannot avoid not buying a MALDI, because this is improving the diagnosis such way, especially in case of both bacteria and fungal identification. Few minutes you can give the identification. So you have to have MALDI in case of this identification. Antibody detection does not help in case of immunosuppressed host. Antigen detection is excellent in cryptococcus and histoplasma. But in rest others, it is not so useful. But see the progress. This is the T2 magnetic resonance enabled nanoparticle mediated rapid detection of candemia in the whole blood. This particular technique has improved such way that when you compare with the BACTEC or BACTI alert, that T2 can diagnose a case of candidemia within 3 to 4 hours, whereas BACTEC takes almost 2.6 to 3 days. But problem with this T2 is that it can only identify 5 species, but in Asia already I have shown 31 species in our that particular study of candidemia across 27 ICU, and there is chance of contamination. And you cannot replace completely the conventional technique because it cannot perform the antifungal susceptibility testing. T2 is being used in Western world. I don't know exactly what would be the cost when it comes to Asian countries, but this is one important development which is there. Next, you know, quite a number of times surgeons, they send a sample whenever they are finding any mass to the histopathology laboratory. And histopathology, they can identify all septate hyphae as aspergillus. They cannot identify whether it is fusarium, scedosporium, that is the problem. And surgeons never suspected it can be a fungal infection. So they didn't send any sample to the mycology laboratory. And here, what we have found now, either doing immunohistochemistry or extraction of the DNA from the tissue, or doing in situ hybridization, this would really help in case of identification of the species. What we have seen is that in fresh tissue, our success rate is 90%, and formalin fixed tissue around 70%. Very recently, this is still online, we have published molecular diagnosis of rhinocerebral mucormycosis on fresh tissue sample. You can identify the species. These are the progress which have been done. So in case of identification, you can go for proteomic approach. Already I have said a MALDI. MALDI not only identify the species, possibly it can do also antifungal susceptibility testing and also molecular typing. What is MALDI? Let me just give an introduction because some of you may not be aware of the MALDI. Here the laser, usually there is plate on which you have to put the growth from which this laser, after hitting it in the surface, they produce a spectra. And this spectra is compared with the database, and by this process the identification happens. So there is, when there is hitting this, they produce this different, this is the tube from which they are going, and ultimately this is the capture area, detector area, which developed this particular spectrum. So what we did is that we did the sequenced yeast for standardization, and then we tried to do the validation. We had to update our database because some of the species which we see in Asian countries were not available in case of the database. And that's why when we updated it, our identification has improved nearly 99% of the yeast which we could identify. This is very interesting. This paper had just online is there, where we have shown that look into the fluconazole resistant and fluconazole susceptible, there is complete spectra difference. So possibly this antifungal susceptibility testing can also be useful. So that way MALDI is now such a situation, we put everything inside the MALDI and try to say identify it. And this way you can also identify where is the food is there. So friends, what we need to do, what is our situation is that at present moment after this clinical infection when it happened, we can do this current diagnostic methods. And that way, if it is there diagnosed, we go for targeted therapy or we still go for empiric therapy. But as I said, the real dogma in case of the fungal management is you have to do early diagnosis, even before clinical infection. So you have to diagnose it when there is biological infection, and that way you can give the targeted therapy or preemptive therapy. So all these biomarker tests had come that is helping us to certain extent in case of diagnosis. So look into the difference between proteomic and genomic approach in case of biomarker. Biomarker can be proteomic biomarker or it can be genomic biomarker. In proteomic biomarker, it is promising, but the success is still limited. The success limited because you know you cannot do the amplification of protein. You can amplify DNA. So here you have to have some test which is very, very sensitive. That can pick up this picogram of the amount of the biomarker. But if you increase the sensitivity, chance of contamination increases, that is there. And in case of genomic approach, pre-amplification possible, so it has got higher sensitivity and specificity, it would have low turnaround time. And moreover, what it happened, like suppose we do for galactomannan. Galactomannan release when the fungus is actively multiplying. Suppose patient is on prophylaxis. Because of prophylaxis, there is no active growth which is there, but the fungus death is not there. Because of that, sometimes this galactomannan is false negative. There possibly, if we can have a test on genomic approach, that would really identify it. So, but still that challenge remains in case of clinical samples, how to go for it. As I said that I am not pessimist, I can give you this example. This is MD Anderson. MD Anderson of 1017 patients with hematologic autopsy, they found that 75% were not diagnosed before death. That was their scenario. But this was 84% or 75% which were not diagnosed postmortem, but by the 2004 to 2008, when they started using this biomarker, their detection rate quite improved. From 84%, it had come down to 49%. So this way, there is improvement which happens, and that way you can go for preemptive therapy. So what are the existing biomarker tests? In case of this, CRP and procalcitonin, there are a lot of debates are there. Serum galactomannan, BL galactomannan, serum β-D-glucan, these are there. But new biomarkers are Aspergillus PCR. You can combine with galactomannan with PCR or do Aspergillus lateral flow or BL β-D-glucan. Mucorales also, there is some attempt to diagnose it. And there is breath volatile metabolites detection which is there. Come one by one. These are the some studies which are there, which showed that compared to the bacterial sepsis and systemic candidiasis, in bacterial sepsis, procalcitonin and CRP level is much higher compared to the systemic candidiasis. Even there is shown that if you go for procalcitonin in bacteria, it is much raised, not in case of candida. So a patient who is suspected of sepsis, if the procalcitonin level is not going up, possibly you can think of fungal sepsis. But again, I am saying you, there are a lot of debates still going on. We need a good study. There are multiple studies are getting published, but we need a cross-sectionally multicentric study which can really resolve this problem. That is a very important issue. At least if we can procalcitonin, we are doing, so it can help us in identification. Going to the galactomannan, what is this test? This is a capture ELISA which is there, and this particular test had been reviewed in several meta-analyses, and it had shown that different cutoff to define on this. Better performance has been seen with the undergoing intensive chemotherapy compared to the solid organ. You can see that in case of the sensitivity of hematologic malignancy is 58%, solid organ is 41%, and the specificity is higher in case of hematologic malignancy. So this is a diagnostic driven approach which can be done. GM monitoring every 3 to 4 days combined with clinical and microbiological evaluation with HRCT. This is A2 recommendation which had been given in case of the ECMET guidelines. So this is very important issue which you need to have galactomannan test in every laboratory. What about BL galactomannan? BL galactomannan, it had shown that sensitivity is even better than the serum galactomannan. And if you use cutoff 0.5, that would really help in screening the patients if the patient is having infection. Especially, I would say that in non-neutropenic patient, serum galactomannan is usually negative. The reason is neutrophil engulfs galactomannan and takes away. So in neutropenic patients, serum galactomannan may be positive, but in case of non-neutropenic patient or non-immunocompetent patient, the serum galactomannan may be negative, but BL galactomannan really helps in case of diagnosis. But friends, galactomannan test has got a lot of false positivity and false negativity. Look at this false positivity, host-related false positivity, iatrogenic blood derivatives if the patient has just have blood transfusion, intravenous solution containing gluconate, treatment of antibiotics derived from the fermentation of penicillin, though at present preparation tazobactam cross-reaction has come down with the improvement of the test, but still there is some cross-reaction had been seen. If you are collecting the sample where there is cotton swab or cardboard has been used, environmental contamination, presence of non-aspergillus fungi. What Dr. Retnu was telling, that you can see it can cross-react with histoplasma, not only histoplasma, it can cross-react with penicillium, alternarium, piscidiomyces, geotrichum, even rarely cryptococcus. And even when the patient had taken pasta or yogurt, then also it can become false positive. False negative, when there is chronic granulomatous disease, treatment with antifungal and long-term storage. I'm giving a story that's a very interesting story published in New England Journal of Medicine way back in 2013. This is a female patient, HLA mass stem cell transplant had been done from unrelated donor. Serum galactomannan was monitored twice weekly from day zero to this transplant period. And galactomannan increased suddenly from 2.2 and 3.01 on day 32 and 34. At that time, patient has graft versus host disease, but she was completely afebrile. She has no pulmonary sinus or pulmonary or sinus symptoms, suspecting of aspergillus. CT scan of brain, sinus, abdomen, everything was normal. But galactomania has gone up. But you cannot avoid, because galactomania has come up in a stem cell transplant, they started voriconazole. But there was an intelligent clinician. He went and took the history of this female patient and found that this female patient had taken ice pop during this time. And when it had been seen, all the ice pops has cross-reaction with galactomannan. So friends, galactomannan false positivity is an issue. You must take care in this. So pros and cons of galactomannan test is that it is FDA approved for serum and BL, detectable preceding clinical infection, BL galactomannan precedes serum galactomannan, good positive and negative predictive value in hematologic oncology patient, but it is not yet standardized in ICU patients, and there are several limitations which already I have mentioned. So this is the pros and cons of galactomannan test. Coming to the another biomarker test, I don't know whether you do it or not. This is 1,3 β-D-glucan test. This particularly limulus lysate, this limulus, this is horseshoe crab, and this has got the lymph which is coming up, and this lymph was being used earlier for detection of endotoxin. Endotoxin factor C stimulated, activated, so this is just like blood coagulation. It is one factor stimulating another factor. This was going on from ultimately proclotting to clotting enzyme. Now, what it had been found that in fungal cell wall, there is presence of this 1,3 β-D-glucan, except in case of mucor and possibly except in case of cryptococcus, most all other fungus contain in their cell wall 1,3 β-glucan, which stimulates factor G to activated factor G, and that can be detected. You can see how this test is so useful in certain situations. Look into these ICU patients where empiric therapy had been given. And this patient, of these 21 patients, when baseline was negative for β-D-glucan, then discontinued anandrolone on day 4. And none of them had developed candidemia even up to day 30. So this is a very good test to screen out whether the fungus is present or not. Conclusion, early discontinuation of this therapy is possible if you do this therapy. This has been evaluated in hematology-oncology patients. Also in case of ICU patients, these are the usual recommendations which have been there. This is a pan-fungal marker except in case of mucor and possibly cryptococcus. Positive before clinical symptoms develop and helps to monitor the therapy. And good performance, especially in case of pneumocystis. Pneumocystis, it is very good test for detection of it. But there is also false positivity, difficulty. You need a specialized laboratory to do the test because it is very prone to contamination. Even there is a fiber of gauze can make it contaminated, and of course the cost is very high still now. Coming to the nucleic acid, genomic approach, where do we stand? You know, PCR based detection method should have been ideal for doing either the real time PCR, that would be the most important one. And these protocols were being tried for last 20 years. So many papers have been published. But still, it is not included in the URTC-MSG guideline, though in last team meeting, we all voted that it should be in the URTC-MSG guideline, this particular PCR test. Just compared to the virology. Virology laboratory, everything is being done with PCR nowadays, and they have got different types of protocol. But still, they could do it, because we are dealing in virus more than 10 to the power 3. At least 10 to the power 3 copies are there where it can do for this PCR. But in fungus, the problem is too few fungal DNA in the sample. That is the problem. PCR inhibitors are there, and contamination is a big issue. Even so-called sterile tubes have contained 10 to 20% of the tube contain aspergillus DNA. 80% of the commercial tubes with anticoagulant have also fungal DNA. But what it happened is that in European group, especially 39 laboratories together, What they did is that they did a standardization. And this standardization has come out and it's a very good one. What they have recommended is that take large volume of blood. For the PCR to take more than 3 ml of blood is very high. But the elute volume should be very, very minimal. As you can go for a minimal elute volume, that would be best. So elution should be in small volume. Mechanical lysis better than enzymatic lysis, and you should have internal control and ITS test. So if you see, this is one important study which compared the GM ELISA with β-D-glucan with PCR. You can see these are the different commercial systems available. Even in case of PCR, there are available, but none of them is well standardized. So I cannot recommend anyone, but this have been tried, and when it had been compared with this, both the sensitivity and specificity is comparable or even better than other two tests. If you can see in case of the non-culture test, here the question which he was asking, I can take up this issue also, very important. You know, always we are excited, okay, GM positive, so you start therapy. Okay, it is β-D-glucan, it is positive, then start therapy. But now there is an approach called Bayesian approach. What is that approach? If blood culture is negative due to low level of candemia, β-glucan and PCR are unlikely to make diagnosis reliably. If the patient is in low risk group, positive result does not help, but negative result excludes the disease. That is very important. If the patient is in high risk group, then positive result increases the likelihood of invasive candidiasis. But temptation is that because we don't have any straw to catch, we at least try to catch something. That's why people say in case of sputum, even candida is there, so we start therapy, which is absolutely wrong. These are last straw to hold to justify your antifungal drug. Here also, the temptation is that because it is short turnaround time, you can start early therapy. What we should do is that we tend to believe non-culture diagnostic test can identify blood culture negative primary or secondary deep-seated candida. So what I generally feel is that at least do two positive tests. Two positive tests are compelling. Similarly, multiple negative results are also compelling. So one test, just you have no culture, you have no direct microscopy, you have no HRCT suggestive, just don't go by one test like GM, which happened in ISPOP. So I would say be careful about it. But when this has been combined, this has gone very good result. Look into the GM and PCR when combined, the sensitivity improved and specificity also improved. So if you have got no positive result, most unlikely it has got invasive aspergillosis. If it is both positive, it is most likely having got disease. If it is one positive, it cannot confirm or exclude the disease. Similarly, there are multiple studies. I can quote so many studies, but I have no time to quote all these studies. But all of these studies have showing that if you combine these two tests, PCR and galactomannan, it improves the sensitivity and it really gives you what should be done. So friends, what is the consensus? Consensus is that in aspergillosis, you can do these biomarker tests. There is increasing evidence. In cryptococcosis, we have got very good test antigen. You can do PCR test also, it's good. Histoplasmosis antigen test is very good, you can do. But mucormycosis, still we don't have any, whether it is PCR or antigen test. Other molds, same situation. In Candida, you can do PCR, you can do manan-antimanan test, or you can do β-D-glucan test. Now, just few minutes with this new techniques of point of care test. What are the new techniques available? One is this lateral flow assay. This is a microfluidic assay. This is very good test. It had shown that even it is better than so-called PCR and latex agglutination test. The cost is also very minimal, and this has been evaluated in many centers. It had shown that you can see this lateral flow assay compared to the others. The sensitivity is almost parallel, but it is even a little bit better. It is not statistically significant, but even this test is little better. So lateral flow assay is replacing in case of cryptococcus. What about aspergillus? You know, there is a lateral flow test. This is not detecting galactomannan. This is a new protein which is detecting, that is GF5 protein which is being seen. And this has been used for detection both in case of the serum and BL sample. But still this particular kit has got a lot of variability in sensitivity, specificity among the different laboratories. You see how much it is specific. It is shown that it is in Asperger's fumigatus, it is positive, not in Rhizopus, Fusarium, Candida, or even in Cryptococcus. And when it had been looked into, evaluated all these tests, serum showed less promising result, but BL sample showed much promising result. And this had been evaluated in case of the solid organ transplant, intensive care unit, respiratory disease, hematologic malignancy. All of them, if you see, the sensitivity is very good in case of solid organ transplant patient. So what is the current status of Asperger's lateral flow? Use test is better with BL sample, most promising in non-neutropenic patient, no data on serum in this group. Use can be with combination with PCR, non-specific binding evidence, so it is still not CMART strips are observed in many countries. Till more data available, I cannot completely recommend this particular test. So we need have lateral flow in case of Aspergillus. This is Dr. Johnson, she did her PhD on this. She is from England. She did this proximate ligation assay. She detected the same JF5 antigen, but she did what? She did combine the proteomics with genomics, which could amplify. And this, she found that this is a very good test, even better than lateral flow in detection. Again, I am saying you, it's not a single person's recommendation. Always a single person's recommendation is good, but when it has been performed in other laboratories, it had not shown the same result. So it needs, but it is in progress which is there. Even cedar fall production by Aspergillus, that had been tried. And this is possibly can be a good test in future, it is still not clear. But this is one test which people are trying, breath test, as it had been done in case of Helicobacter. You have heard about Helicobacter by breath test. Similarly here, E-nose test, which is there, highly effective in invasive Aspergillus in neutropenic, it had shown to be good sensitive and specific test. Basically, they are detecting this particular organic volatile compound. And this test shows, at least till now, the results are very enthusiastic, but it needs the standardization. Until that, we cannot say anything. But friends, when my question was, or my discussion was, how you can apply in case of Asian countries, that was at the heading of it. So we did this study from our Asian fungal working group. This particular paper has been accepted still to be published. We did this number of laboratories across these Asian countries. And what we found is that if you look into this, okay, antigen, histo, candida, I am not bothered about this much. This is absolutely required. But look into the galactomannan and β-D-glucan PCR and therapeutic drug multi. This is being present in only 22.8%, β-D-glucan almost 10%, PCR 37.8%, therapeutic drug monitoring 38.1%. And what we found is that it has no access of biomarker almost in Indonesia, Philippines and Thailand. We could not have Malaysia at that time. Now we are getting the Malaysia. We need to know what is the picture in Malaysia. So this gap analysis shows that in case of Asian laboratories, we still need to have a lot to go for incorporation of all these biomarker tests which is not available. So summarizing what I tried to tell you is that detection of fungi in blood and tissue, rapid identification of fungi and antifungal drug resistance in clinical samples is the interest of the clinician. Proteomic approach, especially MALDI and biomarkers, is still promising, but there is more need of genomic approach. Because as I have said, the biomarker is costly and it is having got chance of contamination. You need expertise, you need very good specialized laboratory. But genomic approach, especially PCR, which might be cheaper, it has got own problem. Here, European Aspergillus PCR initiative is a bold one, but commercial closed system required. New initiative, already I have said, a point of care test. Even people are working on genetic susceptibility, especially CARD9 deficiency, STAT1 deficiency. These are the certain deficiencies which have been found to be linked with fungal disease that has been looked into. In Asian laboratories, we need investment. We can use lateral flow assay type of thing, which is cheaper option, and we need to develop reference laboratory in each country. Asian Fungal Working Group is taking a serious effort in this regard. I would say that we thank Pfizer in this. They have given a good grant, on educational grant. On that grant, we are trying that from each country, we can pick up the people who can develop reference laboratory to different laboratories. We are supporting them and getting them trained so that they can come back and start reference laboratory in each country. Thank you for your kind attention.